I think that a lot of people didn't realize that the original English dub was done in Toronto, Canada, and it was done by Canadian actors. So that's something that we're really kind of proud of. And we get asked a lot at different cons how we felt recording Sailor Moon, and if we had any idea that it would become as popular as it did. And of course, we had no idea that it would become as popular as it did. Not a clue, because usually stuff that's done in Canada, it doesn't become popular. No, I'm just kidding. We end up doing a lot of series, and they're fabulous series, but for some reason they don't go as far as we would like them to go. So this one was a really great surprise. And it took a long time to realize that it was popular. And I think that one of the main things that made it popular was that when it went to American distribution, and it was on, what channels was it on? Sorry? Cartoon Network, that was the main. Now I understand in some places it was on at some crazy time, like 6 o'clock in the morning. Is that 6 o'clock in the morning? So we had a lot of folks telling us that they would get up before school when the whole house was still sleeping, and that they would climb up onto a stool and get some Twinkies or some Cheerios down from the shelf and sit there and watch Sailor Moon at 6 o'clock with nobody in the house awake but them. And I thought, well, that's a good thing, that it's, you know, teaching everybody to get up nice and early and greet the day. And then some folks said that they also watched it when they went home from school, that it was on at, and so it was on two times a day. Oh my gosh, that's just amazing, amazing, amazing. So first of all, so I'd like to ask if anybody has any particular question that they would like to ask about Sailor Moon, or about recording Sailor Moon, or anything at all. Does anyone have anything that they'd like to ask? Hello, Miss Pink. You're so pretty. The craziest moment I ever had as a voice actor. Well, there have been quite a few crazy ones. And then sometimes, you know, you just go in and do your thing and you leave. So very often someone will say, did you do such and such a part in such and such a series? And I'll think, no, I don't remember. I mean, it sounds crazy, but if you go in and you record for 15 minutes and it was 21 years ago, you really don't remember. But one thing that I do remember, I hope that this is an over 18 crowd. Are we over 18? I do remember this, and this is the only time that this ever happened. My agent said, I have a job for you on Friday morning, and it's dubbing, and it's a live action film. So that's something that actors do. You all know what dubbing is. Some the sound wasn't good, and so they have to get actors in to revoice it, basically. And a lot of times the actors, they're not happy with the actor's voice or actress's voice, so they'll say, let's bring in somebody else to, you know, replace that voice, and it might sound a little more in character. So I went into this this job, and I arrived, and I said, hi, I'm Susan Roman, and do you have any scripts? And they said, oh, no, you don't need any scripts. I said, I don't need any scripts. I'm dubbing. do you want me to just make up my own words? And they said, no, not exactly, but you don't need any scripts. So I said, okay. I was very young. So I walked into the recording booth, and there's the microphone, and there's no stand because there's with no scripts. So they said, okay, we're going to start rolling, and here's the scene that we want you to dub. So the scene started, and it was a porn film. And I said, wow, and it was not a soft porn film. It was a very explicit film. It took place in a washroom somewhere with a sink and some pearls. And so I stood and watched it, and I said, now what do you want me to do? And they said, well, we want you to make the sounds that that woman on the screen is making. And I said, I don't think my mother would approve of this. So, you know, you have to do what you have to do. I was really embarrassed, and I said, "Oh, I'm going to kill my agent." And I did indeed. Actually, afterwards, I went back and I said, "This is never going to happen again. I can't do this. I just can't do this." It made me very uncomfortable. The second part of the story is when the actress, whose back was to me on screen, turned around. It turned out that I knew her. And I said, "Oh my, I'm sure she doesn't want anyone to know that she did this particular film. So I'll just keep this under my hat." But it was just, so and then I saw her, I guess, a couple of months later. I didn't say anything. Yeah, I mean, what do you say? I know that you did a porn film, and I dubbed your voice. I mean, what are you going to say? No. So, and it wasn't her voice. It was her moaning and groaning. Oh, it was just awful. But anyway, so that was the craziest thing. And as I said, that never, ever, ever happened again. Thank goodness, because, you know. Anyway, any other questions? Yes?
First, I just want to say I think you're awesome. I absolutely love you, Sailor Jupiter.
Oh, thank you.
Part of what I loved about the original series and about Sailor Jupiter's original character is that she was such a strong, independent character, which I identified with growing up.
Right.
And I was wondering how you feel about the more feminine version of her character in Sailor Moon Crystal.
Well, thank you for your compliments. That really means a lot to me. I'm serious. It means a lot to me. I have not, in all truth, I have not seen a lot of the Sailor Crystal dub, which is coming down incrementally, right? I mean, there's a part of me, I think that I would like to watch it in some sort of continuity so that I can get a real good sense of it. And I think that's a fair thing to do. If somebody's put a lot of work into something, if you just see little snippets of it, you're not going to get the flow and the arc the way that you would if you see it in its entirety. So So that's what I would like to do. So consequently, I've only heard the barest snippet, and so I wasn't really able to make that decision or come to that conclusion that she was a little less tomboyish. But you're saying, you assure me that she is less tomboyish, or she's more girly, or how would you describe it?
She's still characterized as the kicked out kind of scary character.
Scary?
When
all
the boys are like, "Who's that girl?"
Oh, yeah. Right.
And she just generally has, I think, a more feminine air to her. I think we've seen a little bit more of her softer.
Right, right.
Rather than her being just that strong character, which I think is interesting.
Well, it's funny, somebody just came over to the table where we're doing autographs, and he had recorded an entire episode of the original English dub. I think it's the one Jupiter comes thundering in, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
I was listening to it. He's got the whole thing on his phone, and I'm sitting there listening. And there are, especially in that episode, there are a lot of transitions where she does become soft and gooey and a little more female. You have to but she also had more lines in that episode. So if you're looking at an episode and your character has 5 lines and all of them are assertive, then you have to go along with that. You can't suddenly go, if the line is supposed to say, one of my favorite lines, "This thing is rigged!" I can't say, "This thing is rigged." I can't do it because the action on screen is she's going ballistic, right? So it's an interesting thing to me that sometimes the character, I don't think it happened that way, but sometimes the character that Jupes might have seemed a little bit more less dimensional, that she was mostly fierce. But hopefully, especially in the times when she was with the other Sailor Scouts, and when she was with Serena, when she was just being a normal girl, that you saw that other side of her. Because I think anybody, as no matter, they could appear 90% of the time to be, I'm just, I'm too cool to breathe. I think that, I don't know what I'm doing here, but I think it's all right. But then for 1 second, if I say, isn't it? I mean, is it all right? Then all of a sudden you saw another side of me and you're not going to forget it. So then I go back to being, I'm too cool to breathe. But for that one little second, I let you in on another dimension of me. And sometimes that's all you need to kind of carry it through. I hope that answered your question. I will say they have now introduced the, there's a new American, as you know, American dub of Sailor Moon, and they just introduced Sailor Jupiter. I need some water. Excuse me, water? Does anybody have some water? Let's see. Oh, there we go. Thank you very much. We're going to do it. Thank you. So, pardon me. Amanda Miller is doing the new dub, and I just saw it the other day, and it's absolutely fabulous. I think she's doing an incredible job. She's made it her own, but she's still feisty. And again, that opening episode, there's a lot of feistiness in when Jupes is first introduced, because we have to see that she really is strong and assertive. And that's what that was the thing too. Back in the day, when that first came, when we started dubbing Sailor Moon, there were no animated series or cartoons, as we used to call them, that featured women being assertive and not standing up for something silly or somebody treating them as less than they really were deserving of. So this was all new territory, and I remember going home and saying, this is, I can't believe that they've put an animated series together with not one, but at that point, five characters who are female, who are attempting to be superheroes, and who are flawed. That's what we all love. That's what we recognize, is the flaw in all of us. We all have flaws. And I think the more we share that with each other, and the more we are honest about who we are, the more we can connect to people. Because we all know, I don't know where this myth started, that so-and-so is perfect, or so-and-so is perfect, because it makes us stand back from them. We don't feel connected to them. But as soon as we find out that they're just like us, they're not perfect, then we feel a connection, which is an interesting thing. And yet all of us are trying so hard to not let anybody see our flaws. So, that's a thought. Anyway, any more questions? Yes, sir. I tried to, good question. There's a school of thought that says, if I'm doing a feisty character, then I can't go in a tight pencil skirt and high heels. That's craziness. I can't get the feeling of it. So when I did her, I always tried to wear boots, and I always, kick-ass boots, I wasn't wearing mucklucks, let's put it that way. It's not going to work. Because, you're standing there, you're always doing animation standing up. I always do. And so, the microphone stands here, and when we're doing Sailor Moon was dubbing, so there was a screen in front of us, very much like a karaoke screen, with the words going along the bottom. And it was, you all know what karaoke's like. It's like follow the bouncing dot. But in this case, we had to say the word when the word hit the black vertical slash at the left-hand side of the screen. So sometimes the words came very, very fast, and other times they went really slowly. So it really affected how you acted, because you were very, very hamstrung by how fast or how slowly these words went. But then when they were fighting and in the battle scenes, those words went like stink, right? Boom, 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 boom. And if I'm standing there in my little skirt and being all femme, it's not going to work. So it's always wear those boots. And when you, as women and men, when you put on a pair of boots with heels on them, how do you feel? All right, right? You feel a little stronger, a little more, I don't know. The costume really, really helps. So I just made sure that I did that. And then my hair was longer, and I would always put it up in the ponytail so that I could, just do a little swishing motion. And there are actually some photographs of that first, the very, very first season. Katie Griffin This was her first, she was Sailor Mars. This was her first animated performance ever. And she had long black hair. She looked just like Mars. It was the most amazing thing. Just this big, thick, long black hair. And I had brown hair up in a ponytail. And there's a shot of us recording together. You know, we've got our headsets on and we're recording. And I thought, oh my God, they, look at that. And I suddenly realized that every single actor kind of looked like the part they were playing. It was really interesting. Anyway, the costume helps. When you're at theater school and you're doing any of the classic plays, if you're doing Shakespeare, bless you, thank you so much, thanks. And you're doing Shakespeare or any of those classics, you have to go to rehearsal dress, and you're, if you're female, you have to go in a rehearsal skirt. Because you're not gonna get the sense of that age and that period unless you're dressed in clothing that makes you feel that way. No matter how much of a method actor you are, you all know from putting your, you know, doing your cosplay, when you put the costume on, everything comes together, doesn't it? It's an astonishing thing. And guys doing period stuff, they've got to get out the tights and get out there and go, whoa, I never knew I was so handsome. Any more questions? Well, of course I would, but it's, you know, it's been done, it's been decided. There are, you know, when anybody takes on a new project, they want to make it their own, and that includes casting it. And so, you know, you look at a project that's already been done, even just think of films that have been remade, they would never, you know, take somebody out of the mothballs and bring them back again. Well, not that we're in mothballs, but they would never take somebody from before and use them again because they want to put their own spin on it. I mean, that's what life is all about. It's about moving forward, right? So I know that, I mean, if I were producing the Crystal Moon series, I would want to make it my own. I would want to cast it perhaps differently. But from what I understand, the American dub actors are moving over into that side of things too, I think. I read that somewhere on the internet. By the way, don't believe everything you read on the internet, right? Right, I mean, some of the things that I've read about myself and I think, really? Oh, but and you go, who do I contact about this total lie here? I don't know. Oh well, forget about it, because you just have to realize that a lot of stuff, you just kind of, it's a little kooky. Would you like to see the original actors in the Crystal Moon series?
Personally, yes. I mean, I grew up on it. I grew up on Mary Moldy, all the old stuff, and it's just like, okay, you know, I would love to see them all get back to doing it.
Wow, it would be fun. There's no doubt about it. It would be fun. But it's also fun to put a new spin on it, make it an entirely new event, and it certainly looks different than the original. It presents very differently. And yes?
How did you and the rest of the cast feel about not dubbing over Sailor Stars, the last season of Sailor Moon?
Well, it was just such a weird thing because we finished doing whatever season we finished on. Because we didn't do it sequentially. So some days we would be, recording episode 31, 64, 29, 101. You see what I'm saying? It was very all over the place. So we left, and the producer said, we'll see you in 2 or 3 months, to finish it off. Because we knew that we had to finish it off. Everybody wanted to find out what was going to happen. And then we never got called. And I would phone my agent every once in a while, and I'd say, "Wait, what's up with Sailor Moon? When are we still have another season and another whole whack of stuff and to record, and I don't know what happened, and I'm never going to be able to find out what happened, because don't forget, this is all before the internet. It's not like I could just, you know, go on YouTube and say what happened and watch it in Japanese. I didn't have any access. We didn't have any access. So he said, "I don't know what happened," and it just literally disappeared. It was like, you know, the black hole of Calcutta. One minute it was here, the next minute it was gone. And it was never explained to us. ever. So we're just as much in the dark. There are fans out there who really make a point of knowing all the behind-the-scenes activity, and they can tell you all sorts of stories, but even those stories don't necessarily sort of jive with one another, so I don't know what is the truth. Yes? Yep.
From what I've been hearing, it's going to be with the new cast that's dubbing the new dub that's happening.
That's what I heard, too.
That's what I've been hearing. About Star, the reason why they never dubbed that is because they did not want to release it in the U.S. They were saying that since they had a large a lot of children watching it, and some of the content probably wouldn't be appropriate with the three stars, and that's probably why they never continued the dubbing.
Well, you know, I have heard that, and that seems to make a lot of sense to me, because it did get, as we know, the opening episodes, some was cut, and a lot of people who had seen it, at that point, not a lot of people had seen it in Japanese. It was only later that people saw it in Japanese. But as people started comparing the Japanese, but it was the original animation, as they compared that with what was done in America, they started saying, well, hey, wait a second, we're missing a whole bunch of scenes here. Certain scenes are not true to the original. Certain scenes are maybe not making sense because they don't match up with the original. And then there was the debate about the Sailor Moon says at the end of each show. Well, so here's the situation that's really, really easy to explain that. And that was, when it came over from Japan, it was aimed at the demographic, meaning the age group that it was aimed at, was young. Whereas in Japan, it was on at night, and it was aimed at an older audience, an adult audience, who would be quite able to, and loved it. It was obviously hugely popular. But when it came here, it had to be tailored for a younger audience. And so I hear people say, you know, oh, I hate censorship. Well, this is the thing. So if you're watching it on, was it ever on Nickelodeon? No, it's only the comedy. In Canada, it was on stations which were absolutely primarily meant for children. And if they're called the broadcaster, if the broadcaster, and they had access to everything that was recorded and the scripts as well, and if they saw certain things in there that were inappropriate for children, they would run the risk of just pulling the whole thing altogether. For example, there's this whole Bible that says what you're allowed to do and what you're not allowed to do, what you're allowed to say and what you're not allowed to say, and what a simple little thing, like a child riding a bicycle without a helmet on, that's going to have to be cut. If that comes in from another country where it's totally fine to depict that in an animated show, that's okay for that country, but that cannot be shown in, I'm sure it's the same in America, but certainly in Canada, anytime you show a child on a bicycle, he or she has to be wearing a helmet. So some of the things that we're showing in Sailor Moon, daggers, kids going to school with daggers, you can just imagine they're saying, well, you know, I don't think that's necessary. No, that's not going to go over. And if the broadcaster doesn't want it in your series, it has to be cut. And if you don't cut it, then the broadcaster doesn't want the show. It's as easy as that. So if those cuts had not been made, the show never would have been seen by all you guys. It would have been perhaps aired at night to an adult audience, but I don't know how successful it would have been. Can you imagine your moms or your dads watching that show at 8 o'clock at night? Would that have gone over? I don't think so. I don't think my parents would have watched it. They would have said, honey, there's a cartoon on at 8 o'clock at night. What's that all about? Right? Because it just didn't happen. Because they, you know, and again, look at how things paved the way for what we have now. You know, we have all these adult animated shows, animated films meant for adults. It's opened up a whole world of new creative expression. So it's a good thing in the end of all. But there were, you know, there's hurdles that had to be surmounted along the way. Anybody else? Yes, Mr. Green Hat. No, tell me, what's your favorite moment from the show? So, what is sometimes reality bites? That's all she said? Oh, isn't that funny? I'm not remembering that. Sometimes. Oh, in that silly voice. Silly voice. Oh, you know, I'm going to have to watch. What episode is that? I'm going to watch it again. I just saw a little clip of it. Okay. Well, somebody will know. Someone somewhere will know. And they can, usually someone, there's someone in the audience, in the crowd, who just goes, episode 41. Yeah, 16 minutes in, you go, okay, thanks. There's some real experts out there.
That's the one with Andrew, right? Yeah. That he's trying to make a date with Rachel, and she's teaching him how to cook.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Yeah. I can't remember.
And she's really keen on him and doesn't realize. And then there's this whole thing. What is it, his girlfriend's name? Rita, okay, yeah. Okay, now this is all ringing a bell. You have to realize how fast, when we're doing it, how fast that scene would have gone by. It would have just gone by, I would have recorded it, and then it would say, let's move on. So that's why I appear to be somewhat of a dimwit when you're, you know, and I'm going, oh yeah, and then what happened? Like, I wasn't even there. Sometimes I wonder if I was really there. No, I was. But my favorite line always, and somebody just pointed this out, but she does say it at least 3 times, maybe 4 times, but I don't know, but you kind of remind me of my old boyfriend. I love that line. That's just, you know, as if that's a good thing. I mean, really. My old boyfriend was like a total idiot, but you remind me of him. Sorry. Okay. Any other questions? No, oh, everybody's being so quiet. Come on, I know there's a secret little question in there. Now, are you wearing that because you're sick, or?
No, I'm a K-pop fanboy today.
Okay, great, cool. Love it. Okay. No, it's just I'm thinking of going to the emergency room. We have these clinics in Toronto, and now it's winter, so everybody's sick. So you walk into the clinic, and everybody is wearing a mask. Only they're wearing a mask because they're sick. But they try to make it look a little more gorgeous. But they're all sitting in the clinic like this. So it's, you kind of go, ooh, I don't want to be here. There are sick people here. Yeah. So, yes, sir. Yeah, we've gone to quite a few places, and it's been terrific. I just have a soft spot in my heart, I have to admit it, for Americans. Because I just think Americans are so open and honest, and don't be insulted, but there's like you've kept hold of your child, the part of you that's, and the child, which is innocent and psychotic. Well, hopefully not too many children are psychotic, but it always charms me. And when I go home, I sometimes feel that people are a little colder, a little more cut off. They're just in the elevator in the hotel. This is so bizarre. Someone gets on the elevator and they go, "Good morning," or, you know, "Good morning," or whatever accent they have, and I go, "Oh, good morning." Because in Toronto, nobody says anything when you get on an elevator. It's like you get on and you just look at the floor. Everybody looks at the floor and like that. Because, I don't know, it's just a little more cold and cut off, I guess.
How have your experiences with Canadian fans been different than your experiences with Americans?
I think that overall, We had such a great experience. We did something called Fan Expo in Toronto a year ago, and it's a really big one, over 100,000 people through the gate. It's a huge, huge thing. And those kids did us proud. I mean, they acted like Americans. It was great. Meaning that they'd come up to the table and they'd say things like, this is what we get all the time. They just stand there and they'd say, you were my childhood. And I go, really? And to see Canadians so overtly emotional was absolutely terrific. And it was just to think, and a lot of them didn't even know we were Canadian. And they'd sit there and they'd say, you're Canadian? Oh my God, I thought you were American. I thought you were American because the show was successful and we all know, anyway. So so it was absolutely great. So in the end of all, I think Sailor Moon fans are, I could not tell any of them apart, no matter what part of the town or the country we were in. And we were also just in Malta, at a convention in Malta, and that was really interesting. So some nice fans there. Most of them saw the dub in Italian. In fact, a lot of them learned to speak Italian by watching the Italian dub of Sailor Moon. Hello, did you guys learn how to speak English by watching the English? No, I'm just kidding. You were going to say something? Yes. Well, what do you think a Canadian accent would be? A. Oh, yeah. Okay. American. So here's a funny thing. I've done a lot of work that went across the border. So series that are being sold in Canada and the United States have to have an accent that is neutral. So, of course, there were no A's in any of the stuff that we did, because that Americans really don't like that. I mean, they've done some sort of psychological tests or whatever, and that you're talking away, and then you say, it was a really good party, eh? And everyone goes, whoa, you know, like, where did that come from? But I'll tell you, this is what we have that is very different. And if we were recording stuff that was meant for an international audience and we didn't get it right, it had to be re-recorded. And that is the OU sound. So this is how it goes. We say about, it was about 14. You say, it was about 14, right? Do you hear the difference? So if I'm doing this wonderful speech, and it would be the same in Sailor Moon. They would send it back if it was incorrect. So I'm doing this wonderful, like, 89-line speech, and right in the middle, I say, so, yeah, it was about 14. The whole thing has to be redone because of that horrible OU, well, not horrible, to this distinct OU sound that we find, Canadians find normal, but Americans, they go, not that they go, there's something wrong with it, they go, it sounds alien. And so they stop identifying with that voice. So my mantra used to be, when I was recording, first when it first came out, it would be out, out, about, green card. This was my mantra. Because you could not possibly go to LA or New York and audition to work or hope that you could work in the United States if you did not have that OU sound right. And here's another one. We had to, there's so many words we had to change. We say sorry. And of course it's sorry. So you're acting away. Not only are you trying to keep your eye on the time, the dialect, the character, the mouse flaps, but when you see sorry or dollar, or all the ones, you know, and even worry. So we've got a tight O sound for worry, so it has to be more of like, don't worry, and we're don't worry. I'm sorry that I left you out. I'm sorry that I left you out. You see, so it's like, it's almost like not being yourself. So sometimes I go home and people say, why do you sound so different? And I say, well, I'm working on my green card. No, I say, I'm trying to get that open sound. Were you about to talk about the sorry? It does throw you off. Wow, I'm amazed that they let that go by, because usually they're very, very, very strict about it. Now, there's another thing that I just wanted to touch on rather kind of quickly. When we're talking about accents and dialects, way back when, this is even like before any of you guys were born, there was a record put out by she was a young girl at the time, and named Moon Unit Zappa, and it was called Valley Girl. Has anybody ever heard of that? And it was, she just spoke through the whole thing. And when it first came out, everyone's going, what? Like, where is she from? What is that accent? What is that dialect? What does it mean? It was fabulous. So this is easily 25, 30 years ago. So I used to do a lot of, I still do, radio and television voiceover. So I got a call from a producer, and he said, can you do that Valley Girl accent that Moon Unit Zappa does? And I said, I'll listen to, I went out and I bought it. I think it was even a record, no, it was a cassette. So I bought the cassette, and I listened to it, and I had to write it out phonetically, because I couldn't understand a word she was saying. Like, I want you to listen to what I'm saying in terms of how far everything has come. I couldn't understand her enough to be able to say, I think this is what she's saying. And I wrote it out phonetically, and after a while, I got the hang of it. And I went in and I recorded a whole bunch of spots in the Valley Girl accent, and they became like the rage of Toronto, because it was the first time that anybody had actually done commercials using that accent. And what happened was that that accent became the way you guys speak. So it was the basis for it. So let me just, give you a little taste of one of the verses. And the reason that she spoke this way, I finally figured it out, is because she didn't want, it's so simple. People say, how do you do accents? How do you do dialects? And I say, you figure out why someone speaks the way they speak. And you all can do it later when you leave in the shower so no one can hear you. She didn't want anyone to see her braces. So when you don't want someone to imagine, you got all this metal across here, what do? You don't move. Under no circumstances are you allowed to move your upper lip, right? So a normal person, the upper lip moves, the bottom lip moves, the mouth is open, you got all sorts of stuff happening, but the upper lip can't move. So then all the sound has to be stuck in the bottom area and at the back of the tongue. So it sounds like this. Just watch my upper lip. So I go into this like salon place, you know, because I want to like get my toenails done. And the lady goes like, oh my God, like your toenails are like so grotty. I was like really embarrassing. She's like, oh my God, like bag those toenails. I'm like, sure. She's like, oh, barf me out, gag me with a spoon. I was like really embarrassing. So you see, all I've done is keep my upper lip. Thank you. Thank you. And there's a cup at the door with the change. No, I'm just kidding. So as time went by, this lilt, you know, became part and parcel of the dialogue of the way that people speak. So everything went up at the end of the sentence. So like everybody's suddenly speaking like this. And like even the guys are like doing it. And it's like, hey, dude. And then it's like, hey, dudette. And like suddenly everybody goes up at the end of the sentence, and so you say, okay, like in 20 years, is it gonna sound like, hi, I'm your doctor, I'm gonna take your gallbladder out? I don't think so. So then, as a response to that, everybody started going down at the end of the sentences. So then that became, my favorite thing is well, I'm too cool to breathe, you can get into that. Do you guys have that here? So I'll be talking away and I go, well, it was really okay. And then we went over and we had some food. And then after we had food, you know, we went out for some dessert. And it was okay. And it was, what the heck? Do you think this is attractive as a woman? Do you think that's like sexy? Is that attractive at all? So a lot of my contemporary friends, their kids talk like that, so they end up talking like that. Hi, Susan. How are you doing? It's Catherine, your oldest friend. Really? I didn't recognize you. Well, you know, I talk like this because I'm too cool to breathe. Anyway, Catherine, she'll never see it. Any more questions? I think we're getting to the end slot, are we? 10?
Yes, ma'am.
10 more minutes. What are we going to do? Hello. We saw literally the first day we recorded The producer said, okay, I'll show you the Japanese dub. Okay, here it is, 1, 2, up there. And it was up for maybe 4 or 5 minutes. I don't know what scene they showed. I have no clue. We stood there and we went, oh my God, they talk fast. Holy cow. And I couldn't tell, because it was in Japanese, I couldn't tell who was talking. I couldn't understand. We couldn't understand anything. And she said, okay, now we've seen enough of the original dub. What is it all about? It doesn't matter. Just read the lines, okay? It'll be fine. All right. So we didn't get scripts. No. But when it's funny, when the when I say we didn't get scripts, obviously there were scripts, but in a really great situation, in those days they didn't have, it wasn't online, but you would get the script mailed to you so that you could actually read it and be prepared before you went in, so you would know what's going on. I mean, that's what happens today before you go in. But this was, dubbing is always a different situation, right? Because original animation is, draw the animation, they draw the cartoon character or the cartoon to your voice. That's original animation. So I've done, you know, in my life, I did Care Bears. I did, Champ. Oh, right, okay, sports fans. Yeah, so that was Champ. So that's done. I did Tintin. All of that, I was the dog. Don't you guys read the program? No, I'm just kidding. So those are all done ahead. We record beforehand, so that the animation is drawn to my voice, so I'm not limited in how I perform that character, because I can take as much time as I want, right? Because it hasn't been animated yet, it hasn't been drawn. But if you're doing dubbing, it's already drawn, and you have to take your energy and your interpretation and fit it in to that mouth flap and that amount of time. Now, what if the mouth flap is going like this, right, side to side, and the line is, ow! Now, how can I go, ow, if the mouse flap is going side to side? What do I do about that? I have to fix it, right? Otherwise, you can't go, ow, and it doesn't work. So you have to go, ew! So all of a sudden, so someone would say, why did you make that weird sound? I made that weird sound because it had to match the lip flap. Sometimes the decisions that are made about what you see are so boring and stupid, you have no idea, and you think, oh, that was so deep. It's amazing, you know, the way that sounds just sounded so animal and guttural, and she was just going right into her real soul to get that out. No, I wasn't. I was trying to fit the lip flap, right? So sometimes it's amazing how crazy some of the decisions are that have to be made. And people think they're a lot deeper than they are. So, does somebody have a really good boffo wrap-up question? Do you want me to bark for a little while?
Do it!
He was always drowning, that poor dog. He's always drowning. I mean, I loved it. 43 episodes of barking. I would drive home and say, I am one lucky girl. This is outstanding. Sorry, go ahead.
I was going to ask, do you have any future projects planned?
At the moment, no. At the moment, I'm doing guest things on stuff that comes up. This is really fun, because then you just do, you know, crazy kooky characters that you don't usually get a chance to do. I just did something. That'll come out later. But animation is, you never sort of can rest on your laurels. Right? You always have to go out and audition. And I'm kind of in a transition period now. I used to do a lot of little boys, like Champ. I did a series called Fisher Price, Little People. And I played the little boy, Eddie.
Oh, I really like you. I think you're great. I'd really like to play with these toys a lot, because these toys are fabulous.
And I played his little sister, Sarah Lynn,
who goes, "Oh, Eddie, I think that that's really silly, because I don't think you should be drinking scotch."
So it's now, that so in that day and age, women would often do little boy voices. So then this transition came along, and they said, hey, here's a really kooky thought. Why don't we get little boys to do the little boy voices? And I said, that's not fair, because little boys don't pay mortgages. But so now you'll find in most of the animation out there that the little boys are indeed played by real little boys. And it has a completely different sound to it, which is, you know, very real. And it's a little less slick, because of course an adult can read dialogue better than a 10 or 11-year-old kid can read. But because the 10 or 11-year-old kid is going to read in a more halting way, it sounds a little more natural, let's say. So then when you guys are into, like, you know, Bakugan and Beyblade of older days, let's say, and now you're into a lot of other, I mean, there's just so much Japanese-based programming that's out now. I was just reading the programs before I came here, and I said, holy cow, I have not seen most of this stuff, because I don't even know where I would find half of it in the backwater where I live. I'm just kidding. I just, in my house, I mean, I don't have access to 25,000. Don't you hate that? Oh my God, I could electrocute myself at this very moment. All right, I'm gonna just do that. You didn't see that. Okay. Okay, we're good. So somebody's gonna come here and say, what happened to this? You know what, a towel would be terrific, but I just wanna save the electric equipment more than the...
The other Sailor Scouts coming up next.
Oh, is Katie coming up now?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Oh, that's, I'll put it on the chair. She'll never notice. She's probably drunk now. I'm just kidding. You know, that's the other thing I have to say. That's the greatest part of doing all the traveling that we've been doing, is that we didn't really know each other when we were recording, because a lot of times we would record by ourselves. So we'd go into the studio and we'd come out again and we'd say, hi, how's it going? Oh, great, fine. Okay, see ya. So it was all like that. We really didn't know one another. And we've started traveling together, and we've been through some really interesting situations and some tiring situations. You know, flying back from Malta was a 19-hour day. And you get to know someone after 19 hours, let me tell you. You really get to know them. And we realized that we all really have each other's back, and we really like one another. It's kind of like art imitating life, or life imitating art. Like, all of a sudden, we've become Sailor Moonies, and it's really great. So listen, in parting, I just want to say thank you so much for your support over all the years. I wish that we'd have had a chance to maybe do this on a day when there were more people at the convention, but no, I'm going to take that back. I'm really glad that it was nice and intimate, because you guys are terrific. And thank you so much for being... Ah! Thank you. Thank you so much. Oh, wow. Gosh. Okay. Now you be nice to Katie when she comes in.